Moving to the bat monitoring squad here, but Kim was talking to a couple of different cats that's gone all right, so we'll go on that. So I want to start off talking about white nose syndrome. So white nose syndrome was discovered in a cave in upstate New York in 2006. It's the disease itself is a fungal infection that's native to Europe and Asia. And since its introduction to the U.S., it has killed off an estimated 7 million bats. It started over on the East Coast and it's been traveling ever since. It grows on the hibernating bats because it's a cold-loving fungus. It specifically affects them when they're in hibernation over the winter periods. It invades their wing tissue and it damages the wing membrane, which is important because their wing membrane not only is useful for flight, but it's also how they kind of regulate homeostasis, and the damage to the tissue eventually causes dehydration. But the primary cause is that it disrupts their physiology in a way that disturbs them from hibernation. So they should be sleeping all winter long. The fungal disease gets on their nose, it gets on their wings, it gets on their body. It causes them to arouse frequently over the course of the winter, which is not what they're supposed to be doing. Like bears, they're supposed to kind of be tucked away, sleeping all winter long. They put on fat reserves. And if they're waking up, those fat reserves deplete. And especially if they arouse and they go for a flight or two, there's not going to be any insects out. They're going to have no forage. They're not going to have any way to kind of recoup those losses from waking up. And so the primary cause of death is actually dehydration, starvation, due to the depletion of fat reserves. So the fungus itself that causes white nose syndrome is known as PD. Pseudogymnomascus destructans. I'm not going to say it once because I'll trip every other time. And this is the latest map that was issued back in February of this year. So as you can see on the map there, it was detected in 2006 in New York, and the color gradient here, the greener colors are the earlier detection sites, so it was primarily limited to the U.S. Northeast, and then it's spread since. You can see the yellow and the orange gradation is progressing through 2010, 2014, and then starting in 2015 and 16, immediately to the Midwest. The Rockies were thought to be a natural barrier. Maybe it was thought that kind of rather hopefully, because bats on the east side of the U.S. and North America here tend to kind of just migrate back and forth within that, and then same thing with the bats on the west side of the Rockies, they tend to just kind of stick to the west side there. So, as a society, we had really been hoping that the disease wouldn't progress across the West, but unfortunately, in March of last year, it was detected in Washington State in three different instances. And so now that it's on the West Coast, there's nothing really stopping it from moving up and down. So that's bad news for bats. So how does it spread? It's a fungal disease, like I said. It spreads bat to bat during hibernation, also during migration. There are a lot of migratory species of bats, and they can carry the disease from one hibernaculum over to another one. And because they can do it through migration, they can also do it through translocation, which is what happens when a bat accidentally hitchhikes a ride on a ship or a boat, or those are the same thing, sorry, a train, an RV awning, anything like that. I'll talk more about that in a little bit. PD also does spread through human clothing and equipment. So when the disease was first discovered, the primary mitigation responses was just to close all caves and require anybody that's entering caves or coming from caves that are in contaminated areas to decontaminate all their clothing. The major problem is that these infected caves and mines will act as our environmental reservoirs, and so long after the bats are gone, and in some cases these caves have held hundreds of thousands of bats, and the mortality rate has been anywhere between 70 and 90 to 100%. So a cave can have had 200,000 bats on it. Those bats can all be killed off, but the disease will persist there because it's a cold-loving fungus. It'll stay there for, and we don't even know how long, we assume it'll be pretty much indefinitely. So it doesn't allow any other bats to recolonize that area, and because caves are really sensitive, delicate ecosystems, you know, fumigating the entire thing is going to cause a lot of problems. So there isn't really a solution that we have on hand when the disease is established in that area. So a little bit about basic bat ecology. They are the only flying mammals. They are not, in fact, rodents, despite the fact that the name for bats in other languages is commonly some variation of flying mouse or flying rodent. They have really long lifespans, especially for a critter their size. Chundats are known to live upwards of 20 years or more. They typically have one pup per year. This is what we call a low fecundity rate. So their life strategy is less like a rabbit that procreates continually and more like a large mammal. And they have a lot of kind of investment into their young. And because they only have one pup a year, it's really, really hard for populations that have been hit to rebound because their life cycle is kind of just more along the lines of a large mammal. They're all nocturnal. They roost during the day. The females will often roost together with pups in maternity roosts. So the summertime roosts where you have, you know, a colony of bats in your attic and they're not there in the winter, those are probably maternity roosts. And the females will all band together. The males often won't be in the maternity roost. And males can go into torpor, which is advantageous evolutionarily because if it gets cold during the summer for a week or two, there's not a whole lot of bugs. Come on in.
Oh, we're just seeing it. Sorry, I got a truck full. I'll bring them in then.
Oh, okay. Yeah, please.
A truck full of bats.
Maybe. That's a lot. So during the summer, if there's a stretch of cold weather, the male bats can go into torpor, which is a little kind of a mini hibernation. They can go into a partially induced sleep to preserve their energy reserves until it's a little bit warmer and then more bugs are available. Females cannot do this because they are lactating, they've got pups to feed, but on the flip side, though they can't just go to sleep and wait for warmer weather, there are less bats out there competing for the bugs that are around. So it does help them, the females. Winter roosts are known as hibernaculum. Bats are found worldwide. They have global distribution. There's over 1,300 species around the globe. There are 47 species in the U.S., and we have 7 species here in Alaska. A little bit about their morphology. So as you can see from the diagram here, their wing is comprised of the bones that make up you and I's fingers. So that's, you know, that's the humerus, radius, ulna, and then these are all their little finger bones. So if you and I had bat wings, we would literally be walking on our fingers, because that's how long their wings are, just underneath them. A little bit about the taxonomy. I always mispronounce this. It's Cheoptera. This is a little bit of a dispute based on recent genetic evidence, but the historical classification has always been there are megabats and microbats. And these megabats are all the fruit-eating bats that are found pretty much exclusively over in Asia. They're quite large, so some of them have 4-foot-long wingspans. As you can see, they have pretty big eyes. They have perfect eyesight. They don't tend to echolocate. There are a variety of species here. That's a hammer-headed bat. That's a flying fox. They're beautiful and beautiful creatures. They are also considered a food source and hunted in some parts of Asia.
What's the specialization of a hammer-headed bat? Bizarre.
That's a really good question, and I have absolutely no idea.
Okay.
The only thing I know about this little kid was that it was kind of implicated in the recent Ebola outbreak. It's the only association that I have with it. So over in North America, all we have are microbats. They're all primarily insectivorous, and they all use echolocation to some degree or another.
Okay. You got questions. Can you take questions throughout? Or
absolutely. Throw them out.
I was just curious. You said you thought 7 million bats have been killed in North America?
Correct.
What do you estimate? What's the estimate of the total population of bats in North America?
Oh, I don't know that there is one, to be honest. Mm-hmm. Bats are really understudied as a whole, and bats in places like Alaska, for example, are a total mystery. We're just now learning about them. One of the big problems with white nose syndrome that was discovered in 2006, there hasn't been a whole bunch of bat research, especially on trying to generate substantial population estimates for the continent. And now that white nose has hit, everybody's scrambling to do that, but we're kind of one step behind.
Mm-hmm.
So unfortunately, I don't remember what it was prior to that. I'm not sure. Yes, go ahead.
So why is it that megabats are fruit-eating? Like, are bugs not sustainable, or like other carnivorous / insectivorous?
I'm not sure. In the taxonomy, it was thought that maybe they had evolved separately from like 2 different common ancestors. Doesn't seem to be the case, and they've kind of restructured the taxonomic clade since. there's a lot of fruit over in Asia would be one possible thing.
So,
yep, fruit doesn't move, bats do. So it might cause, be a little bit more efficient to just be able to go pluck things off of things you can see as opposed to trying to chase things.
Why don't microbats do that?
We don't have a lot of fruit over here, we've got a lot of bugs, I'm not sure. Different evolutionary strategy for a different location, I imagine.
Some small bats eat fruit. In Costa Rica, I photographed a wrinkle-faced bat,
uh-huh.
And in between its wings had, I don't know what the fruit was.
Yeah.
Well, and like red bats in the Midwest, you stick them on peach trees, and you'd pick a peach, and all of a sudden you're like, ah! And the bat is that way, too.
And there, our next slide might be on diet. Nope, diet slide's coming up, though. So a little bit about echolocation. So echolocation basically works the same way your fish finder and your boat does. You're sending out a signal, and you're listening for the echo and bounce back, and from that you can kind of determine the location and a distance. So all insectivorous bats utilize echolocation. We have these acoustic monitors that allow us to detect and record echolocation calls, and it works by having a really sensitive high-frequency microphone that's able to pick up the bat calls, and then it divides it by a ratio that translates it to something that we can hear with our human ears. With that, I guess it might be a good idea to demonstrate this. So if you would do me a favor, could you rub your fingers together?
Yeah.
Anybody hear anything?
No.
Okay. Could you do that again? Oh, great, great. Do your fingers work?
Yeah.
Okay. So, when you rub your fingers together, it produces ultraviolet frequencies that we can't usually detect. And this does, because it falls within the range that's detected by the microphone. So, bat calls work the exact same way. And we can use these devices to monitor bats. They're stationary monitors that we can kind of set out. This is a more active monitor. And I'll go over how specifically we're using for this project
so
in a minute.
Are the bats in Europe, they're resistant to the fungus?
They are, yep.
And how does that continue all the way to Asia then? Or how large is the population of fungus resistant bats?
I believe so. I believe it's kind of all of Eurasia. And I don't know how long, on an evolutionary scale that they've, been mitigating it and the population has had to stabilize. I haven't seen any papers trying to determine how long that's gone on, but it definitely wasn't native in North America or not. It's susceptible and have no resistance to it. Okay, so here's my diet slide. So the vast majority of bats eat insects. There are quite a few fruit-eating bats, as you guys mentioned. There are some insectivorous bats. There's also some meat-eating bats. There's a Mexican bull. What is that? Mexican bullnose bat? A Mexican fishing bat? No, that's the best one. That's a bullnose bat. And then there are also three species of sanguivorous bats that feed on blood. These species are only found in North America, specifically, or South and Central America, really. And out of those 1,300 species that we talked about worldwide, only three of them eat blood, which is pretty amazing, especially considering that they have all their PR is built up around Giraffula, three or four little species. But the really cool thing about these guys is most of them actually feed off of birds. There's one species that prefers cattle, and its range expanded substantially with the advent of modern cattle farming and the range expansion of cattle. But they're beneficial to us because the anticoagulant that they have in their saliva has been developed as a stroke treatment, which is pretty cool. Also, from a behavioral ecology standpoint, they're really neat because they do something that we don't think any other animal does, in that they will share food, because blood is a really poor food source, so they'll roost together, and they have to feed every night. If they go more than 3 or 4 days without feeding, they die. And so if a bat flies out and it tries to forage and find a bird to suckle on, and it doesn't, it is significantly weakened, and it returns and it can get food from its neighbors. Their neighbors will regurgitate some amount of their food to the other bat, and oftentimes these bats aren't even related, so it's kind of this tit-for-tat altruism that's pretty neat and pretty unique in the animal kingdom.
I remember learning that the Mora rotunda at least gets a bunch of the water out of the blood so it can drink a whole lot and then fly quickly, so
mm-hmm.
it like has a rapid action in kidneys that can process that really quickly and then dump the extra water.
Oh wow, cool.
So they can still fly even though they just tanked up.
Gorged, yep. Yeah.
So since cattle aren't native to North America, what did those cattle drinking bats do before they were introduced? Did they just eat other things?
I don't think so, yeah.
Okay.
And
why
then they
did
just
they
kind of
latch onto cattle?
Opportunistic movement, yeah.
What's the name to sort of Central America, are they?
We got into Mexico.
So these are the bat species we have in Alaska. Remember I said there are seven. Five of them are Myota species. You'll notice that they all look fairly similar. It's very, very difficult to tell these guys apart, even if you're, you know, good at it and have some practice. Oftentimes the difference is the length of a little piece of cartilage on the ear or the length of the arm. It's pretty tricky. We've got some bat specimens up here. There are some type of Myota species. Don't ask me what, because I certainly couldn't tell you. And then we have two of our tree grouping bats. We've got a hoary bat and we've got a silver hair bat. The Yuma bat, we think that the northernmost distribution is probably right around Ketchikan. I don't think we found it farther north than that. And the little brown Myota is by far the most ubiquitous bat and has the largest range. That's the one that's found on the East Coast. It's found all the way up kind of to South Central Interior. It's just about everywhere. Unfortunately, this little guy has been decimated by white nose syndrome on the East Coast. So while it was once the most abundant bat, it is slated to perhaps go extinct within the next 20 years or so.
That's the hoary?
I know, that was a little brown bat.
Little
brown myotis. Here, like I said, this is the range. It goes all the way up right around to the Berks Range almost. And you can imagine this line continues on through Canada as well. It doesn't just stop at the customs border. So how do we know what we know about bats in Alaska? A few years ago, we went out and we misfitted a bunch of bats. This was around the Juneau area. We placed little radio transmitters on them, as you can see on that little guy. I think it's a King's Myotis. There's a little pill-shaped thing there, and a little head of radio antenna. And how it works is it pings. It just sends out these pings and signals, and then you can fly around with a receiver and try to figure out where these bats are. And bats in the West are known to migrate long distances from feeding sites to hibernaculum to roosting sites. So we got up in airplanes and we were covering a large area, and as it turns out that they didn't go very far. We caught all our bats over in North Douglas and Juneau, and the furthest away they went was Admiralty, which is, you know, maybe 100 miles there. So then we have to get down on the ground with those same transmitters and hone in and see if we can figure out where exactly our bats are going. And it turned out, and this is pretty cool, that a lot of them were roosting in these little rock crevices, which is something we had no idea about. We know that they roost in buildings, we know that some roost in trees, but this was kind of a novel thing. And we started wondering, okay, well why? What makes these good hibernaculum for these guys in the winter? And so we placed data loggers outside the roosts. And this is a little bit of a chewy graph, but I'll walk you through it. So this pastel line on all the graphs is representative of the temperature outside of the hole, or the relative humidity outside the hole. Temperature is in blue, relative humidity is in red, and then the bold line is what it was inside the roost. So as you can see from the top one, which is relative humidity, in an exposed rock roost, one that wasn't covered in snow, outside the relative humidity bounced all over the place. And this is really bad news for bats because they don't, you know, they're in hibernation. They're really susceptible to desiccation and death by dehydration. They need something that's really, really nice and moist and humid, like a cave, like a mine, something along those lines in order to make it through the winter. And outside, it jumped around a whole bunch. Inside, it was nice and high, and it was nice and consistent, which is also important. And you can see the same thing with temperature. Outside, the temperature dipped and it dropped. Inside, it bounced around a little bit. This was an exposed rock roost, so a little bit more exposed, a little bit more fluctuation. But by and large, it stayed pretty much right around 0 degrees centigrade, which is about what they need. They can't freeze, but they need it nice and cold consistently in order to maintain that low metabolic rate. And in a snow-covered roost, the results were even better. It was really, really stable, pretty much primo optimum conditions for both humidity and temperature. So other bat research that's being done, there's the North American Bat Program, which is something that we participate in. It's a fantastic, as the name states, North American-wide research program that focuses on having passive monitors spread out on a grid, as well as doing driving surveys, and we've participated in that for a couple of years now. That's what our stationary monitors look like. We do have one in Cordova. We have a multitude of them spread throughout Southeast, and then we have wonderful volunteers who do driving surveys for us. So why are bats important? They're important to ecosystems overall. Bats are pollinators. The fruit that we eat, a lot of it is pollinated by bats, bananas, mangoes, those of you who drink tequila, agave. They're very understudied. They're imperiled, not just from white-nose syndrome, but also from habitat loss and from wind farms and from pesticides. And the tragedy about wind farms is that the bats seem to be attracted to the way that the sound that the blades make as they're spinning, and these blades will spin at an incredibly high RPM, and the pressure gradient that's created between the wingtips and the center of the turbine is so drastic that it just completely disrupts their physiology, and the bats are killed not even just by running into them, but just by being kind of in the general vicinity. The wind industry has been super helpful and cooperative and contributing to research as to how we can kind of mitigate this impact on bats, spinning them at different speeds, running them at different times, not running them at certain parts of the day when bats are really active or night. The tragedy about pesticides is that bats can consume thousands and thousands of bugs per night, and they're crucial to the agricultural industry down in the lower 48. They're a really important pest control mechanism, and the more pesticides they put out and the more pesticide-covered bugs bats eat, the more bats are going to die from pesticide poisoning, and the more we're going to need to dump pesticides onto our crops to make up for the fact that we don't have bats eating our bugs. So that's kind of a double-edged sword for them, which is pretty sad. Here in Alaska, it's a huge, sparsely populated state. We have a handful of people studying bats. We don't have very many boots on the ground, and our resources are super, super duper limited. I'm based out of Juneau, my boss is in Juneau. The Forest Service does some bat work, but you know, again, it's maybe 20 individuals throughout the southern part of the state. So that is where you guys come in. The data that we've collected over the past few years has been primarily collected from citizen scientists. And citizen science is a bit of a neoism, but the concept behind it has been around for a long time. Fields such as astronomy and ornithology have benefited from public input and data collection for centuries. The backyard bird count has been going on since the 1900s. Things like the transit of Venus and other really crucial events in astronomy were discovered by people that were just interested and cared and wanted to get involved and contribute. Currently, citizen science projects are global. With the advent of the internet, it has just created a wonderful mechanism for compiling data and making it presentable and accessible by any number of research institutions or people who are interested in it. You can go online and your kids can look at satellite imagery of Antarctica and help contribute to whittle seal population counts. You can stare at your computer and classify galaxies and space dust. You can sign up to be on an amphibian brigade where you help frogs cross the street during vernal pool mating season. If you can dream it, there's probably a really great citizen science project already out there, and if there isn't, you should probably make it, because it's needed. And in today's age, with the internet and with funding, citizen science has become really, really important research overall. And so my working definition of citizen science is that it's crowdsourced scientific work performed by members of the general public, usually in conjunction with or at the direction of professional scientists. And so our program here is the Citizen Science Bat Monitoring Project, and we have people do writing surveys. A little bit of backstory behind this is that we got this program up and running about 3 years ago in communities around Southeast, Ketchikan, Gustavus, Wrangell, Petersburg, Sitka, Haines, and Juneau. Ketchikan was kind of our pilot test study, and we're no longer doing driving surveys there, although we do have some stationary monitors set up. We're no longer doing Gustavus either, but we've expanded it up to Cordova this year, and this will be the first year that we're trying to do this here, which is really exciting because we expect to gain a lot of insight as to what bats in Cordova are like, which species we have here, where they hang out. It's thought that Cordova might be the northernmost extent of the range for a couple of different species that we have here in Alaska, but we really don't know. So how this works is at Fish and Game, Charlotte has generously offered to coordinate this for us, and we have these lovely driving survey kits that we'll send out every spring. And within the driving survey kits is stuff that Charlotte needs to download them, but there is this handy dandy little box that goes out with people who volunteer. So we have a bat calendar where you can sign up to check out a box. And within that kit, there's everything that you need to do a driving survey. There are instructions, there are helpful little tips, there's a data sheet example, which I'll go over, there's a sunset table, and then there is that handy dandy little Anabat monitor, only the microphone actually gets plugged into this, which is a roof mount, and it's got a heavy duty magnet on it, so you can stick it on top of your car, you run the cord through the window. It's helpful if you have the cord face the back so that the wind isn't rattling it around. Please don't roll your window up on the cord. It doesn't tend to like that. And yeah, so this puts the microphone on top of your car. It puts the detector safe and sound right next to you in the car, and well, as well as the GPS so that we can record your tracks. And as you drive along, you can hear the bats that you're picking up along the road. And it also saves it digitally for us, which is really, really, really important. And I'll tell you why. So how these work is you drive a 30-mile predetermined transect. Here it's actually going to be 24 miles because you guys are a little limited on the roadside. They have to be done 45 minutes after sunset. The protocols for all of this are done according to the North American Bat Monitoring Program, so we need to just be consistent. That's our limiting factor, right? Living in a coastal town, not having any rain is a big challenge. And some years we don't get a lot of data, and that's fine, it happens. But that microphone is really sensitive, and if it gets wet, it won't work anywhere. The steps are, you fill out the paperwork, you turn on the detector, you drive at 20 miles per hour, and I'll tell you why. And once you've done your survey, once you've driven around at 20 miles per hour, and you've filled out your paperwork, if you want to take this detector to your house, if you want to drive around town and say, hey, I remember seeing bats here when I was a kid, go nuts, have fun. As long as you get, you know, the detector kit is checked out for an entire week, if you get one driving survey in during that week, weather, you know, providing, then we're happy. Then do a walking survey, do a biking survey, put it outside your house, take it to your friend's attic, go someplace else that's not on the transect map, you know, feel free to play around with it. We'll use the data, and we'll use it in a different way than we use the transect data, because that's the repeatable, predictable part of science there. But yeah, and we'll be happy to provide you with results, and we'll tell you what bats you have in your attic. So some helpful tips. Review the survey route before you go. There will be a map. I just made one today inside the kit, and it's pretty well detailed, and I'll have you guys take a look and tell me if I need to add anything to it. Do not slow down when you hear a bat. And the reason for this, and the reason for that 20 mile per hour mark, is that the assumption behind this whole model is that there aren't any bats that drive, that fly. I don't think there are any bats that drive either. But there aren't any bats that fly over 20 miles per hour. So the meaningful data that we can get from these driving surveys as opposed to our passive monitors is we can say if you heard a bat at mile 13.2 and you heard another bat at mile 13.5, those were different bats because that bat was not flying faster than you were driving. So we can get an individual count, which is really, 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 really helpful, speaking of trying to formulate population estimates. So that is really, really important, and that's why the 20 mile per hour limit is there. If you drive over 20 miles per hour, the microphone picks up too much wind noise and we can't filter out any calls. It's just a lot of background static. But if you slow down when you hear a bat, and you will, because from what I hear, there's a bunch of them in Cordova, and you'll hear a little, you know, chitter-chattering, then you'll probably pick up that same bat several times and we won't be able to say that there was one bat here, or there were six bats here, we don't know. The survey time should be when the car starts moving, and please do get the time from the GPS because we link all that data later. Please don't leave the detector on when you're sitting in your car doing paperwork before and after the survey. If you, like I said, if you want to collect some more data afterwards, please make sure that you shut the detector off. The call files that are saved on it also tell us whenever the detector was turned on and off, so once you finish the survey, you shut it off, we'll know that that was the end of the official survey, and then you can boot it back up and do whatever you want on the right call. Reiterating that, please do the paperwork. We can't do anything with it if there's no paperwork. And again, we'll analyze any ancillary data that you pick up separately. Helpful hints, if you need to reboot the detector, do not hold the power button down for more than a few seconds. These units are really, really easy to use. There's a power button and then there's volume buttons and you don't really need to touch anything else. This knob here is the sensitivity knob. I don't know if you can see it at the back, this black thing that turns. This is the world's stupidest design for a detector, because this knob, whenever you put it in and out of the kit, gets jiggled around, it gets moved, and we have it all calibrated at the beginning, and we set it so that this thing doesn't work anymore, because it just throws off everything if it gets accidentally twisted, and it does, every time you look at it the wrong way. So when you hold the power button down for more than 5 seconds, that kind of resets everything, and it reverts the digitally calibrated sensitivity back to the control knob, which is really, really bad news for us, because it screws up all our data. But yeah, they go on really easily. You press the power button once, all the lights go on. And it tells you that there's not a microphone attached. Do not eject the CF card with the unit on. Chances are you will never ever need to access the CF card down here. Charlotte has volunteered to do all our data for us, so you don't have to get your hands dirty with any of it. But in the event that you get an error button and it says the CF card is full, make sure that units shut off before you pull it out. And there is an extra CF card, and those are just like just little data cards, kind of like floppy disk. If any of you remember those. The GPS units, there's pretty much no care in feeding. All you have to do is turn it on and off. Do not save or rename tracks. It'll delete the information that we utilize. These are what our data sheets look like. You'll have to use your imagination and say, pretend that that says Cordova on the top of it. So, it walks you through a lot of things. Do not conduct surveys if it's rainy, if there's wet, drizzle, or fog, or if it's windy and windy enough that the trees in the canopy are swaying. It just means that we're just going to get too much background noise, because just like when you rub your fingers together every time the leaves on trees rustle, it creates sounds that are picked up by the unit. Surveyor names. What did I do? I didn't even put it. Don't. If I ignore it, Elizabeth,
you
go click down if there's a down option and do exit. Yeah.
So surveyor names. So that is anybody that's in the car. We have whole families do this. People with seven people crammed into a van. That's awesome, right? Everybody down there, bring your pet dog, bring the cat, bring the family weasel. Write their names down there. Survey start time, survey stop. The survey sunset time should be listed here. And again, there are sunset tables in the kit, so you can refer to that and be all ready to go before you arrive at your destination. There's a thermometer on the outside of the microphone casing there, so you can get the temperature before and after. We've got codes for wind and cloud cover and what the sky's doing and whether the wind's visible. And these environmental observations are important because we can get a calendar that'll tell us what the phase of the moon was, but those calendars don't take into account any of the local topography. So it can say that the moon is full and that it's right above the horizon there, but if it's tucked like right behind the mountains, it's not going to be visible here, and it's not going to be visible to the bats. So we really rely on people's observations to actually tell us what it looks like in the local area. Survey notes, helpful to know things about insect activity. If you make a wrong turn in Albuquerque, please write it down. If you have to stop and, you know, take a pee break, put it down there too, so we can just figure out what's going on when we go through and do the data. So the bottom here. We went through kind of a slugfest in order to be able to get timesheets on the actual data sheets. Months and months of paperwork, people. That's for the government, and that's how it works. The driver and the surveyor should write down not only their time, which includes the time that they left their house, but also the driver gets to count their mileage. And our program, I won't bore you with the specifics of state funding, but our program is matched by the federal government through a special program, and the hours that people volunteer for us and the mileage they put in are matched, and it's kind of the key source of our funding. So this is really, really, really important. This is how we're able to keep this program up and going from year to year. And speaking of paperwork, I was able to get timesheets put onto the paperworks on the chairs that you have here. So if you do nothing else tonight, please put the hours that you sat through my lecture on, and I'll be able to count them and say that we had so many people here that each volunteered an hour or more of their time.
Hour more than charity.
Yeah, precisely. So, this is the route that I went out and drove and figured out today. The start of the transect is going to be the Sheridan Glacier Trailhead, and the end of the transect is going to be the Power Creek Trailhead Gate. Here's a map of what that's going to look like. Again, remember you have to go 20 miles per hour, so I tried to choose roads that were in good enough condition to make it so your teeth don't rattle out of your head. For the stretch of highway here, I should have mentioned earlier that we have swag for your car, because obviously, you know, if you're on the highway, have your flashers on, please, but also there's a slow-moving vehicle magnet, and then there is this ginormous static plane window decal that you can put on the inside of your back window, and it's reflective. And in this day and age, if you're going to be driving around at 20 miles per hour with microphones on the roof of your car, it helps to look a little official and a little legitimate, so. Yeah, so Stewart and Glacier Trailhead, take the highway, and then take a right at the hospital, and then a left on Chase Ave, and then a right onto Lake Ave, and right at the gate again. And it's 24 miles all said and done. And it goes through a variety of habitat, which we're really excited about. So remember when I mentioned that those data are saved onto a card digitally? This is what that digital data looks like when we run it through our program. This is what's called a sonogram. And this is how we ID bats. So remember how similar all those five species of Myotis bats look like? These are two Myotis species, and look at how different their calls are. So this is a King's Myotis, and this is a little brown Myotis. The frequency is totally different, the structure of the call is different. We have pretty good accuracy. We can identify about 60% of the calls that we get to species, which is pretty amazing. So these call files are saved along the transect, and remember how you have that GPS with you? We can tell you exactly which bats you picked up where, which is super, super cool. And I should mention that once we get the data in and processed, we put it online so that you guys can see it after the fact. Usually the turnaround time is about 2 weeks, but if you make yourself a note to go online and check the website and say, oh, I did a survey on June 4th, and I remember hearing all these bats here, here, and here, I wonder what they were, that same transect map will be available online, and I'll show you an example of some of the other communities, and we have little color-coded dots to tell you what species of bats you heard.
How far off the road corridor do you think you picked up bats?
Not that far. It depends a lot on the environmental conditions.
Right.
I'd say probably 30 meters on either side of where the microphone
okay,
is mounted.
Like okay.
Yeah.
So if you hear them, they're very close.
They are, and oftentimes people see them when they hear them, or they'll see them before they hear them.
Uh-huh.
Again, driving at that 20 mile per hour limit allows us to count individual bats. And this provides us with different results than the passive monitors. Because these passive monitors that we have out, we can have one bat camping in front of that unit and eating thousands of bugs per night and calling thousands of times per night. And we'll get all the data and we'll say, oh, there were 1,700 calls at the monitor last night, but we have no idea how many bats made those calls. It could be the one bat or it could be 17,000 bats that all called once, right? So driving survey data is great for that. Also, we have a limited number of stationary monitors, and we leave them in the same location from year to year so that we can try to get an idea of the bats that frequent that area and monitor their populations. But as you notice on that previous slide, well, no, we won't go all the way back, never mind. That broad swath of habitat has allowed us to garner so much information about what bat species are found where. So this is really, really useful to us because we get other data, like habitat data, distribution, diversity, and specific count. Because if we have a monitor set up in one specific location and we're only getting one species of bat that happens to like that ecological niche, that's the only type of bat that we're going to pick up. You guys are totally welcome to come in.
Oh, I know. I'm just listening.
Oh, okay. So this is an example of the data that we get that we throw back out to you guys. So this was a transect that was done back in last year in Haines. You can see that they got variety of bats, right? It looks a little bit like, what's the children's game, Candyland? The start of the transect, they got Keen's Myotis, they got a couple unidentified Myotis, they got a little brown bat, some more Keen's, and I get, you know, so on and so forth. So that's what our product that we give back to you guys looks like, which I think is pretty neat. Like I said, this program has been going on in different communities around Southeast for a couple of years now. This is what our volunteer numbers have looked like throughout the duration. You can see that guest data has really dropped off, so we just continued surveys there. Sitka nails it, which is amazing because they don't have any bats in Sitka. I mean, they have some, but they don't have many. And these people are persevering despite the fact that maybe they'll do the entire driving survey and not your single bat. One really interesting thing is they do have a plethora of silverhair bats, which in all the other communities, little browns are by far the most abundant and ubiquitous, and there are hardly any little brown bats in Sitka, but there are a ton of silverhair bats. So this is all stuff that we've learned from these driving surveys. It's pretty neat. Petersburg and Wrangell have a ton of bats. Juneau and Haines do as well. So from 2014 to 2016, these are the bat calls that we picked up. We had 565 little browns. Like I said, they're the most abundant, except in Sitka. California Myotis and silverhair bat were about tied. There were a handful of Keen's Myotis. And there was a whopping single hoary bat. And this was picked up on a driving survey in Haines. And this is the only hoary bat call, I believe, that we have. So this was really, really exciting. There are no Yuma bat. You mentioned, I remember that there were seven species. There are no Yuma bats here because the extent of their range, we think, is about catching the other way or doing surveys there, but we have picked up the calls on passive monitors. And then we do have quite a few calls that we're unable to determine the species for a variety of reasons. Oftentimes the calls between species of bats for their just kind of movement call, the call that they're making just to get around in the world and navigate through trees, those can be really similar, and it isn't until we get a different type of call, like a feeding buzz, that we're actually able to tease it apart and tell the two different species apart. So oftentimes we can say it's definitely a Myotis species, or it's a either a little brown or a long-legged, but we won't know unless we happen to get lucky with a call or we go out and miss net and determine, you know, in hand which bat it was.
Do they sing like birds, or do they have a version, a song version of the call?
Actually, I had a call, and for whatever reason it wasn't on here. Remind me after the fact tonight, I have a couple bat call examples. They, whenever they're moving, you know, their vision is very poor.
Right.
And so they're just echolocating constantly, and then they have different calls, like a feeding buzz, so they'll be like a click, 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 and then a burr, and that burr is when they detect a bug and they're just kind of honing in on it. And so when they do that, they'll swoop their wings out into like a big satellite shape, and they'll tuck their little tail up under them and do their best to just swoop right on in, and not only honing the sound and the amount of echo that they can get back, but if they miss the bug with their mouth and it lays on their wing, they can just kind of go over and do that. They also do talk, quote unquote. There was a recent study that came out that was, I think it was over in Asia, and they were trying to analyze what the specific calls of hibernating bats all working together were, and I think they determined most of it is family squabbling.
I was like, just wondering if they sing to attract mates or for territories like birds do.
I haven't read anything about it, but I'm a recently converted fisheries tech, so I'm by certainly no definitive bat expert. So if you write down your email, I'll ask people who actually know these things and get back to you. So this is, because we don't have any data here in Cordova, I picked data from all our other different communities to kind of show you some of the results that we get. So this is the combined data that we got from driving surveys that were done in the north side of Juneau at Echo Cove. So the vertical axis here is the total number of bat calls. So on some of these surveys, they're getting like 35 bat calls, and that was in 2006. We run the survey program from beginning of April pretty much through end of September, first thing of October. After that, the bat activity really drops off. But you can see that we get kind of clumps here, clumps there. You'll also notice that we have large gaps in data. Juneau in particular, last year, didn't really get much data at all. And we usually have large gaps around the solstice because we're asking people to do surveys 45 minutes after sunset, and that's a lot to ask. So we're trying to have a little incentive program for people who conduct a driving survey around weeks surrounding solstice. Let's see, I'll kind of run things, get my way, I'll kind of do this as best I can. So this is what it looks like by species. These are all the bats in Juneau that were picked up. This is combined for those years, 2014 through 2016. You can tell that we actually have a lot of silver hair bats as well. Handful of California Myotis, some Keynes Myotis, some little long-legged or little brown or long-legged, and then some unknowns as well. I'm going to skip this because it's chewy and it's not that fun. Then we can, you know, once we have this data, we can do a bunch of stuff with it. This is the little brown's Myotis calls across all the different communities. So Haynes by far had the most little browns in August. You know, it's about tied with Juneau in May and June. Things like that. We can go through and do this for all the different species. The graph here at the bottom shows calls by sunset. So these gray vertical lines are the length of the survey. The triangles are the calls that were picked up during that survey. On hours past sunset, and then the gray line here is sunset, and the reason that it's all squiggly like that is because it's averaged out for all the different communities depending on who did the survey that day. So obviously the sunset in Cordova is going to be a little bit more of a nice little bell curve. For what it's showing us basically here is that little brown bats come out before sunset and they start calling all night long. They come out early and they just are active, they're up foraging. It's different for different species, such as Keynes Myotis right here. So as you can see, there's a lot of Keynes Myotis in Petersburg. There's none in Sitka whatsoever. There's a handful in the other communities, and they do not come out past before sunset. California Myotis, lots of them in Haynes, lots of them in Juneau. They can come out before sunset, and yeah, there are not quite as many of them, but they're not quite as fussy. little browns and long-legged biotis. Remember when I said that some species have really similar calls? This is one of them. So we know it's one of the two. We're not totally sure which, so we just combine the data. Silver-haired. They come out, they tend to prefer to come out a little later in the evening. They definitely peak. This is day of the year, so this is April, so it's about end of May, early June. Unknown calls. So what other results do we get other than just being able to see, say, what species are found in what communities and how many calls of whom do we get and when do we get them? With those environmental parameters that we have folks write down on the data sheets combined with the GIS data that's accumulated while you're doing your survey on the track, we've found things like Keene's myotis bats tend to be more active when there's more cloud cover. Silver-haired bat calls are closely tied to flowing fresh water and old growth forests. Little brown myotis bats are linked to lower elevations and further distances from estuaries. And this one's a little dubious. California myotis bats seem to be found in either old growth stands or clear cuts, but not in other mixed habitats. We actually got all this data and compiled it just 2 months ago, so it's kind of preliminary still, and this one doesn't make a ton of sense. It's either really novel and unexpected and a big surprise, or we just need to use a different model and reclassify our vegetation a little differently. We'll see. So of those stationary monitors, this is from Sitka, and this is really neat. And again, it's a little chewy, and it looks kind of like a unicorn bark all over the page, but it provides some really good information, I promise, and I'll walk you through it. So these dashed bright lines are from a detector that's offshore, it's on an island, and then the pastel solid lines are from a detector that's on the mainland. And so these detectors are put out at the same time. You can see that there's three different years of data here. They're put out at the exact same time, and early on, starting in March through about mid-May, the offshore detector gets a lot of activity. It gets a ton of hits, and then those hits really, really taper off, and then they correspondingly spike on the mainland consistently, year after year after year. And then right around, you know, end of June, beginning of July, mid-July, it really tapers off and drops off there, and then it again spikes offshore. This is super cool. We've speculated on a number of different reasons why. This particular island is where they scooped up a whole bunch of gravel to make the airport, so there's this kind of man-made lake right there, and given that it's offshore, it might be warmer earlier and warmer later and have more bug activity. One thought, we really don't know. We have this data, and now we get to start playing around and figuring out why exactly this is. So, everybody's super excited about bats, right, and really concerned for their plight, and wants to do everything that they can to protect them and help them. In addition to driving surveys, we have a couple other things that we are generally soliciting the public to do. Remember how I talked about translocated bats? We just finished up a study that we presented down at a conference for the Western Bat Working Group, and we compiled 63 plus cases of known definitive accidental translocations in bats. And it is thought that this is a very, very, very underreported phenomenon. Most of these translocations, over half of them, were by boat. And given that Southeast Alaska and Alaska in general is an incredibly maritime dependent location, this is a really major threat to us. Bats hide away in little cargo containers, they hide away in the holds of ships, they hide on go and roost on riggings. A lot of our commercial fishing fleet goes down to Port Townsend and down to Washington, which is now positive for white nose syndrome, and then keeps their boats down there for the winter, where the bats can very likely hibernate on them, and then they could easily transport a bat up here and then release it. So we really want to get the word out. We're going to go to boat expos, we're trying to, you know, just do some outreach with commercial fishing, with the marine lines, all those things, to just kind of let people know that bats do this. If at all possible, we'd like to prevent bats from getting into your boat, into your cargo container, whatever. But also, if you are here and you hear about an anecdotal report of, hey, you know, I brought my boat up from Washington, you know, to get ready for gillnet season, and I got it in a port and six bats flew out, we really, really want to know, because that at least gives us a place to start, and we can up our monitoring efforts, because like I said, our resources are really limited. A lot of our data is dependent on public observation. And so stuff like this gives us a clue, gives us a place to look. We know that we can, you know, up our monitoring efforts. We can get boots on the ground. We can start doing some guano surveys. We can do roost monitoring, things like that. So this is really important. Like I said, boats are the main culprit. RVs are a big one. We're partnering with a multi-agency initiative across North America to prevent bats being translocated in recreational vehicles, because we know that they like to go underneath umbrellas, and they go underneath people's awnings, and then they roll their awnings up, move thousands of miles, and unleash, you know, a possibly infected bat. Camping gear, cargo containers, lumber, and the big surprise one that we didn't even consider were Christmas trees. We collected a handful of reports from wildlife rehabilitators who got called to fish bats out of people's houses first week of December because it had been introduced there when they brought their Christmas tree in. And so Oregon is the top Christmas tree producing state in the U.S., and given that it's right next to Washington, that's a pretty serious concern, because the Christmas trees, in just one company, Holiday Tree Farms, they ship Christmas trees all over North America and other locations as well, including Guam. And it could be a really, really easy disease vector, especially because they're harvesting right at the time that bats are going to sleep and hibernating, and they keep them in refrigerated containers, so the bats don't even wake up. They just are nice and sleepy and in hibernation until they get into your house and warm up. And it's a surprise for everybody. Oh, one last thing about that. We suspect that, remember how white nose syndrome made that jump over to Washington? It was a jump of 1,300 miles, and we don't think that it was somebody with contaminated gear that happened to go from Oklahoma to Washington, and we don't think that it was a migratory bat. We suspect that it was probably a case of translocation. So how else you can help? Please report all sick or dead bats, not just for white nose syndrome, but obviously there have been reported cases of rabies in bats, and rabid bats will act differently. So we have a bunch of flyers in back. I've got one on the screen, Nick. Our flyers look like this. They're two-sided. It tells you what to do if you have a bat or bats on your property, how to tell the difference between a healthy bat and a sick bat, because sometimes the little young pups that are fledgling can act kind of sick. It gives you numbers to call, places to go, and if you find a sick or dead bat, this is our how-to. We have these handy-dandy little dead bat kits, and there's going to be one at the Fish and Game office. They have gloves, they've got a little container, and you can, but please give us a call so that we can walk you through it and tell you exactly what we want done with them. We do PD testing, white nose syndrome, and rabies testing up the state vet in Fairbanks does it. So if you submit the bats and it, you know, heaven forbid it is a white nose syndrome positive bat, if it's not submitted, we'll never know. But if somebody finds it, turns it in, then, you know, maybe we stand a chance in, like, quarantining the specific roost that the bat was found around, anything like that, you know, give it our best shot. Oh, and I think this is actually from Gino. Apologies. So I want to reiterate the fact that all the data that I've shown you, except for the passive monitor data, has not been collected by me. It has not been collected by my boss. It has not been collected by a single Fish and Game employee. All those colorful graphs and all the bars and all the numbers were collected by citizens, by people who went out and helped us out and did driving surveys. And from this, we've learned so much about bats in Alaska, not only their distribution and range, but what species we actually have here and what types of habitat they perform. And this gives us a great baseline. And it's really, really important not only to establish that baseline before white nose syndrome gets here, but also to maintain our monitoring efforts, because this is our best shot for finding white nose if it does arrive. That and people, you know, telling us that they've got a bat roost that we can monitor. So if you know of any bat roosts, I'd also be really interested in hearing about them. We have a webpage online that you can go on to report bat observations, to report a known roost. I'll also be happy to, I'm here till 5 o'clock tomorrow, and I'll write down as many of them as I possibly can. And yeah, go ahead.
I have a quick question.
Yeah, please.
Well, first of all, when do bats in this area birth?
Usually right now.
So that probably answers my question about bat exclusion and when to do it, pre-birthing or after fledging. Somebody in this room has what may be a sizable colony in their attic, a maternity colony, and they're putting a new roof on it. So I heard that work around the bat colony in regards to the new roof.
After waiting until fledging, your guys' bats come out a little later because there's still snow on the ground in parts around here and green up hasn't really started.
They're active for sure.
Yeah, they're there.
Are they getting, okay.
I just was wondering because back east, I used to do exclusion back east, and it was later, actually.
Mm-hmm. I would love to take down your name and number and follow it up with my boss, who is the bad guru.
A couple years ago, when Michael came here, mm-hmm. he set up the saddle bad detector, he went to Jim's house and refused that data back.
I don't think he was able to hear, I don't think he heard anything, I'm not sure.
Did
he? I don't think he did.
Just in his neighborhood, over yeah. time, I observed a few roosts, actually, in that time period, in and around 3rd Street.
Hmm.
I was told 6.5 miles is a really good spot.
Yes, yeah. I've heard that there are just all the bat roosts you could ever want right out there, right out by the boat launch at the little river in lake yeah. there.
There's also a few sizable colonies, Power Creek Road, with those houses, with the Pritchins, which is on an island, and the houses before them. Hersley excluded, but they're still around.
Yeah, I'm sure. They don't tend to go far.
And then some of those buildings going out there on the lake itself, there's a fair amount of bats.
Okay, good to know. My goal is to be able to take all our roost observations and put them on a map and then make it into a pretty easily accessible interface online so people can be like, oh, I know where there's a roost at, and zoom into a map and click and report a roost and also see the roosts around in the area, and then hopefully get volunteers who are willing to go out and do roost emergence counts where you just, you know, sit right around twilight and count all the bats that come out of a location, because that's a really, really great way to get a population estimate and to just monitor populations overall. So yeah, please.
You know, we want to exclude them for our house, but I bought a fat house, you know, I was hoping that they would, you know, recolonize in that. I wonder how effective those bat houses are.
Unfortunately, they don't seem to be that effective in Alaska, but the ones that I know of that have been effective have been a case where there's been a known colony, and then they've been excluded, and bat houses have been put up, and they've colonized those instead. In other locations, if you just put up random bat boxes anywhere, you'll get bats in them. Unfortunately, our bats don't seem to want to do that. But it's always worth the job, especially if you're excluding them.
So is there an optimal size, shape, mounting height, all that stuff for, say, little brown bats?
There's some resources online, and I think on our website we have even design plans for building your own, as well as the name of Yukon. There's a company based out of Yukon that has some specific plans that I imagine are geared. Yeah.
But my best success, for sure, a tip I'll give you there, Bill, is definitely make sure they face south and paint them dark, regardless of what color they are in the kits that you buy.
Yeah.
Paint them black or dark brown. So. They need warmth for birthing. Pretty high temperatures, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's probably the situation with the bat house, the lack of success here.
Yeah.
They may not get warm enough up here in Alaska mm-hmm. for
birthing. I suspect
birthing.
The same thing. Because mm-hmm. the colonies that are typically found are in people's boilers rooms and their attics where it's nice and warm. Mm-hmm. And those females, you know, they can't come to torpor, so they hold together for warmth. And if the bat house isn't warm enough, then it's fine.
And I had a colony inside the hollow part of the bricks in the chimney in my house here, my earlier house. And when I went to take down the chimney, of course the bats flew out, and I was able to catch them. They came right back into the bricks. And I put them in a little box, and then my neighbor happened to have a bat house up, and put them in there, but they didn't stay. It was several years ago.
There haven't been a whole lot of studies, but it is known that translocated bats, whether accidentally or deliberate, will try to fly back to their home. They've got some species that have really high sight fidelity for their
They have filled the hollows of these bricks of the chimney all the way from about 2 foot down from the top of the chimney to the crawl space.
Wow.
So many years, I would imagine, filled that with guano.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
One of the things that we can do is kind of a pilot study, but we're swabbing guano for PD, which is a newer technique, but it's a nice, less invasive way to monitor for the disease. So that's one other advantage for knowing where roosts are and knowing what we can collect.
So,
go to Jim's
house
and get some. Sounds like it.
Yeah, well, I'm replacing the roof, and that's why, you know, we want to take a good time to do it, you know, it's exclusion wise and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I imagine we'd peel that back and find something.
Oh, I'm sure. We need fresh stuff, unfortunately.
Yeah.
We've got one just in here that we're doing, and we just go. I went and cleaned it out a couple months ago, and then every couple of weeks we go to pull some fresh stuff out and dump the rest out and try to collect it and monitoring it. The nice depending on where the PD for the fungus is found, is it doesn't survive in warm temperatures. So bats that contract it late in the winter, if they get their metabolism up and they get out of the sunshine and they're feeding in their warmth, they can beat it. And so hibernaculum, like the maternity roost locations around here, are probably not going to be places where it's going to persist, which is, you know, fingers crossed. Hopefully those graphs that I showed you where we have the temperature stability inside the crevices, I'd like to follow up a study with that in the summer and see what those temperatures are like in the summer to get an idea of the natural hibernacula that they're using to kind of make an educated guess as to whether it would be conducive for one thing that I forgot to drill into everyone's head is that in order to do a driving survey, you have to have one of these forms that are just conveniently sitting on your chair filled out. And what this is it's a volunteer agreement, and it puts you under our insurance because you're doing work for us and you're in a vehicle. This is really, really important. And anybody who's going to be in the car has to have one of these filled out, signed, and turned in to Charlotte, who'll ship them off to me so that I can send them to HR. So this is really crucial. It's for your protection. It's really important. And you only have to do it once per year, I promise. So if you fill it out today, you're good for the rest of the summer if you want to do a driving survey. I'll collect them all tonight, and I'll enter them in and make a little list for Charlotte so that she knows who has one filled out and on file so you don't have to do it again. And the last sheet here is, like I said, a timesheet for the evening. So you've now suffered through an hour and 15 minutes, and if you had a long drive, you're welcome to count your driving time and mileage as well. And I would really appreciate it if you would just write your name down and your signature goes up in the rightmost column there. And we can count all the hours that you've been here today as part of volunteer training hours and get some funding for our program. And there's stickers and brochures and like those what to do if you find a bat flyers back there. Charlotte also made up these beautiful bats in Cordova brochures that are on the table back there. Please take stickers. Take one of everything. There's some bat specimens if anybody's curious. We've got a skeleton of, I think this is a Mexican free-tailed bat. And then we've got some bats in the Tupperware up here. I would encourage you not to touch them, but they're fun to look at anyway. Little Myota species. As you can see, they're really small. And so it's pretty hard to find dead bats. It's easier to find sick ones when they're flying around. That's the size of a cottonwood leaf early in the fall. Yeah, please. And if you want to play with the detector kit or get a personal walkthrough on how to do any of it, I'm here and I'd be happy to stay and talk and answer questions and even let you play with one here. Thank you, everybody, for coming out.
Yeah, thanks. Bats in Cordova Flyer, I worked with Melissa Gabrielson here at the Forest Service, and it's just consolidating what the Forest Service is learning with what Fish and Game is learning, since we both have bat-related projects. So be sure to pick one of those up if you're interested to know a little bit more specifically about what we've learned so far, and then hopefully after you all contribute some driving surveys, we'll have even more to say.
Charlotte, do you have more of these at the office? Like if you have family members
yes.
that want to join in?
Absolutely. And there's also an online.
Yeah, you can take some extras and then you can just start it in the mail.